Bernie Dresel here. Good to talk to you today. Thanks for listening. Here at Memphis Drum Shop. And I want to talk to you about snare drum comping in the swing feel. A lot of people think, like I did when I was a kid, I'm going, what is it? Is it just random? I know the ride cymbal pattern is this. What's going on in the snare drum? Is that just whatever I want to play? Ted Reed exercise one? Or is it just random hits on the and? Is it all these hits that I hear a lot of young players do, the and of two and and of four? It is not that in general. Not one way to play the drums, but there are some better ways. And as I started listening to different drummers, I go, and then suddenly I listened to Billy Higgins and I went, light bulb, there is something swinging about that snare drum comping he's doing. I later found that it was other drummers doing that too, but maybe not as 100% dedicated to this, what I'm gonna tell you about. The general landing spot is not the and of two or and of four. It's the and of one or and of three. It's kind of in the hole of where the ride cymbal, traditional ride cymbal pattern is. Why is that? The and of two and the four kind of feels like you're walking with a limp. You might even bring your right hand into it too. That doesn't swing. We want that quarter note accent in the ride cymbal and fill in the hole in general as a general landing spot, and a one and a three. And if you did it all on the snare drum, here's the difference. Versus the and a two and a four. So there's something about that continual eighth note where you fill in the hole. Now, that's not the only place. As I transcribed just even 32 bars of Billy Higgins, I went, he's really landing on and a one and a three a lot. Or if he plays a bunch in a row, a bunch of ands in a row, the last one you hit is the and a one or and a three. So for example, if I did three in a row, okay, that's three in a row. But you wouldn't do three in a row ending on the and of four. Unless, in general, it would be bar 16 or bar 8 or bar 12 of a 12-bar blues phrase, for instance. So it became like a strategy of where he would put those landing spot ands. If it was bar 1, 2, or 3, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, 11, then that would be where you're trying to aim for and a one and a three as a landing spot. But the end of a phrase, bar 16, bar 32, that would be the end of four or the end of three. So there's something about, it feels like it's finishing, or it feels like there's an exclamation point or a period, something that stops the motion. That and a two and a four, you do use that, but you put it at the end of a phrase, like you would if J.K. Rowling's writing a book. She has to figure out, where's the period go? Where's the comma go? So there's a strategy about where that happens, and that's the same thing in the snare drum comping. That's what I found Billy Higgins was doing, and I go, is Art Blakey doing it? Yes, but maybe he puts an and a four on bar four occasionally. So maybe he wasn't as 100% doing it all the time, but 95. So that's what I felt is more of a swinging snare drum comping. So here I'll play a little bit and just do some of that. Thank you. So there was the last one. I go, oh, give me an and a four there. There's the end of the phrase. Of course, you're trying to see if you're gonna play some figures with the piano player too. And if the piano player is playing the end of two like this, where it becomes a little more of like a big band pattern almost. And if that's what's happening in the horns or the piano, and you're gonna go, I'm gonna catch that with them. And that becomes a figure, that's a different thing. But for this thing about comping behind the soloists, that's the thing that you lay for a little more, and of one, and of three. Thanks, Billy Higgins.